Welcome to the Blind Stigma Podcast with your hosts, Stacy-Ann Buchanan and Dr. Natasha Williams. This podcast aims to provide a safe space that explores mental health within the Black community, breaks down the stigmas attached while taking back our narratives.
Yes.
Welcome to the Blind Stigma Podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Natasha Williams.
And I am Stacy-Ann Buchanan.
Thank you so much for joining us today. Well, as you know, and you know I say this all the time, I love all of our guests, but this one here, this was a good one. This is a really, really good one. And I enjoyed this one.
Yes, I feel like with this guest, they need to get a cup of cocoa tea.
Yeah. Yes.
See what I did there?
Okay. I noticed. Let me tell you just a little bit about this guest, Jael Joseph. So Jael Joseph is a journalist, podcast producer, influencer, emcee, and mom to two boys. She is the founder of BlackIslandGirl.com, an online magazine and podcast that profiles prolific Caribbean women of African heritage, as well as videocast and podcast Cacoa Tea with Jael Joseph, currently in its fourth season. Her beats are culture, race, and gender, and she contributes occasionally to various publications, both in Canada and the Caribbean. Now, here's the thing. I love Jael because what I think our guests or our audience is going to really notice is the juxtaposition of the Caribbean as well as Canada.
Yes.
So that's what I love about her. Mm-hmm. So she's speaking to issues from both ends because she lives in both.
Yes, yes. And I really love that because as Caribbean women, right? we can definitely relate. So I have the perfect quote for Jael.
All right, yes.
It's very short and sweet. And it goes, boundaries are a form of self-care.
I love it.
Right?
I love it. I love it.
Yes.
And listen, once you tune in and listen to what she has to say.
With your cup of cocoa tea.
Right?
Yes.
Right? That quote will come to life.
Yes.
So let's go.
Let's go.
Jael, thank you so much for joining us this evening.
And thank you so very much for having me. It's good to be on here with two Black women.
Yes, honey. Yes.
Indeed. So why don't we just start and dive in? Our first question is basically, what has your journey been, in particular with mental health or mental illness?
Well, for me, I'll tell you where it all starts. Back a few years ago, I owned a spa in Dominica. It was quite a few years ago, back in 2014, thereabout.
Okay.
And I remember having a client, because it was close to the Ross University, and if you're familiar with the Dominica and the Ross University, you kind of have an idea that there were a lot of North American students coming in and out.
Right.
And I remember a young lady who was a regular client of mine, we always used to say, oh, she extra, you know, because this is how
right
Caribbean people see when you behave a certain way, you extra. And
right.
For us, extra meant when she would have exams, she'd always be like very panicky, always like she needed to have massages, she needed to have all of these extra services. We classed her as being bougie, so she always had the finances and the means to pay for things.
Right.
And one time she failed an exam, and she found her results while sitting in the chair, getting her pedicure. And halfway in the pedicure, she finds out she failed, and she had a panic attack. Now, me, I was just like, okay, white people. Right? So my first thing was like, these white people so extra, like, must you be so extra? Must you go on? And she's like, oh my God. Like, she was like freaking out. Like, you know what you do? I was completely like, it caught me off guard. Fast forward into getting pregnant with my first son. I woke up one evening and I was just like, I couldn't breathe. I felt my chest was tight. I was like, what is going on? I'm having a heart attack. So I'm telling my partner, I'm having a heart attack. Call 911. Get somebody to get me to the hospital. Get to the hospital. And after they examined me, the doctor goes, you had a panic attack. I was like, a panic attack? What? She's like, you had a panic attack. I'm like, that's a white people thing. Like, how am I having a panic attack in the middle of the night?
Wow. Right? Jael, let me just ask you one question just to give it context. When you were giving birth to your first child, was that still, were you still in Dominica or were you somewhere else?
Well, I was somewhere else. Okay. When the very first time I had a panic attack.
I see. Happened. Okay. I just wanted to give it context because when you said, you know, call 911 or whatever, I was just assuming that you weren't in Dominica at the time.
No, I wasn't.
But I mean, it just gives some geographical context in terms of, because I'm also thinking that if this happened in Dominica, a lot of times they would not have possibly given you the, you had a panic attack diagnosis if you were in Dominica. So I just wanted to give it a little context. So
very true. Very true. So I had that episode and then I started having them frequently and still not being able to understand what was going on with me. And I'm like, why am I having this? What is causing it? What is triggering it? Because one time I was on the TTC and I had an attack. On the TTC and I had a panic attack. But like sitting in my seat for no reason, all of a sudden I feel like I can't breathe. And like everything's crumbling. And I feel like, oh my God, I'm like, oh my God, Jael, you're behaving like a white person. You're overreacting. So all of this is playing through my head. Right. And I'm unable to figure it out. Being a person of color, especially being a black person from the Caribbean where mental illness is so taboo, even to this, so taboo. I refuse to get treatment. I refuse to go to any therapist. I'm like, therapist is for crazy people. Yes. You know, you watch all of these shows and all of these disturbed, apparently, young people. That's how you kind of see it as, right? So I backburnered this. Like every time it would happen, I would just say, okay, I'm having a panic attack. So my cousins would be like, so when you're having a heart attack, how are you going to know the difference? Oh, you know, like, oh, boy. I just kept backburner. And the only time I actually paid attention to it was last year during the pandemic.
Oh, my. That so you've been was, suffering with this all this time.
For years. Wow. My son is 9 years old. And this happened before he was born. For the first time. Oh
my gosh. Wow. So this was like a decade's journey, Jael.
Yes.
Wow.
So last year, during the pandemic, my little cousin was living with me and she'd lost her brother, her older brother years ago. And as a result of it, she was dealing with a lot of trauma, a lot of things were going on, right? Mm-hmm. And her stepfather, who's white, eh? Mm-hmm. Said to her that we're going to put you into therapy. You're going to need to see someone. You're going to need to deal with this because it's affecting your life. And in the pandemic, it's gotten even worse. Mm-hmm. So me being her guardian at the time, I was given all the instructions as to where to go, who's going to be seeing her and all of this. And after 3 sessions, it appeared that she was healed. I was like, I've been missing out on something because, I mean, granted, she still struggles, but she just felt so much better after speaking to someone on 3 different occasions. Wow. She felt so much better. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to call someone. I'm going to call that same person and see how I can get to speak to somebody. And that's how therapy started for me.
Wow.
I appreciate, you know, your story so far because it's it says so much about how we see mental health in the Black community. Mm-hmm. Because look how we started. It started out with, you know, seeing a white person suffering from a panic attack. And then we separate ourselves from that, saying that's a white people's business. Yeah,
that's something that's extra.
Right? We don't, it's not about us. Mm-hmm. Let them be them crazy self. And so we separate ourselves from that, like, immediately.
Yeah, I can relate to that story, because I remember when I was going through, because Jael, I struggle with anxiety till this day. And a few years ago, it was at its height. It was extremely hard. And I remember when I was told that I could possibly have it. And I thought to myself, only white girls get that. Because being in school with predominantly white girls in Acton, they would always talk about having panic attacks and breakdowns. And I just thought it was something that was associated with white girls. And thinking to myself, I could never bring that kind of talk back home. Right? I could never bring that kind of talk back home. So I didn't really view them as extra. I thought they were really brave. You're really brave to be talking like this. Who talks like this, you know? But it's interesting. Because then when you started feeling it and then the doctor said you had a panic attack, you then automatically thought, no, this is a white person thing. Because I thought the same way too, you know? Mm-hmm. And I tell a lot of people this. And I love how your story goes from your first encounter with mental illness to how you addressed your issues and how you felt to sought help. Because I tell people this all the time. A lot of people have said they never knew that they struggled with anxiety and depression primarily until the pandemic hit. And I said, actually, you probably did. Because there's a form of anxiety called high functioning anxiety, which fuels a lot of people's ambition. So they can't sit still. They call themselves hustler. They're on the next flight. They're doing this. They can't say no. They have a fear of missing out. And that's a form of anxiety. They function high on that. So they live on that. So when a pandemic hit and you're locked down, and you can't go anywhere, then they started to feel it. Then they're like, whoa, what's happening? Mm. Right? And then the other form too is with depression, where it's a high functioning depression, where a lot of people are living lives where they are externally happy and internally unhappy. Mm. You know, they look successful on paper and they think they are unworthy. And so that is so hard to really discover, or to really see that this person is struggling, because they mask their pain with a facade of happiness and success. Mm-hmm. And then when the pandemic hit, you're like, oh my God, because there's no way to escape to.
Right.
I always say, sometimes when you see people traveling all the time, of course it's for work. Of course sometimes it's for a vacation, but sometimes people are trying to escape their realities. Right.
Mm-hmm.
But I thank you for your for that story.
And then the other thing I wanted to mention as well is that, again, it also speaks to this detachment from, you know, saying that it's a white person's thing. But then also the whole issue of, now that I'm suffering with this, I don't want to be seen as white. I don't want to be, you know, I need to stop acting like a white person.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So there's that separation as well, where you're like, no, this is compromising my Blackness, my Caribbeanness.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Caribbean. We don't talk. No.
Yeah. Because, you know, God forbid you end up. Imagine all of this happened in Dominica itself.
Well, you see, now if this would have happened, like, I have a really good friend in Dominica who is a mental health advocate. She's also a doctor. And she has gone through her own, you know, anxiety and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
And so we relate on that level. I mean, we've been friends for quite some time, even before. But now we're so much more understanding of each other's mental health, and when we need to go out and have a girls' night, and when we need to just call each other and cry on the phone, and when, and even she could even tell when I'm going through something based on my Facebook post.
Oh,
wow.
Okay. And sometimes it's not even like, I don't even post things that are depressing, but she could just tell, you're going through something. Talk to me, girl. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's so important to have people, not just my therapist, but people who are around me who can understand it. And the thing about even going to see a therapist, it helped me not just with my anxiety, but with so many other things in my life, like so many other things I uncovered about myself. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm almost 40, and to be learning all of these things about myself, like so late in life, I was like, but what was I doing all this time? Like, I would say to my sister, go to a therapist. And you know, I'm like,
yes.
Like everybody like just needs to go to a therapist. And I started like really absorbing a lot more readings. Like I listened to, granted, he's kind of like his own person, Charlemagne the God.
Yes, we're team Charlemagne the God over here.
I read both his novels, you know, and I read Shook. And when I read Shook, I even understood what it meant, what I felt, like even driving in Toronto, you know, and always being scared that I'm going to get pulled over and always watching the speedometer.
Yes.
You know, these are things that I've gone through regularly, you know, like when I say regularly, every single day. And it might not have been as extreme as where I felt like I was losing my breath and I had to, like, everything was shutting down. But, you know, the small anxieties of being followed in the mall, like, I had that happen to me, you know. And I wrote a small poem once for a class where I spoke about, you know, anxiety of, you know, I dropped my wallet and they got my wallet and the police was following me to give me my wallet. And I thought that I was going to get it in trouble. Oh, you know, no. I was in trouble with the law.
Yeah.
You know,
That's the hypervigilance. So, if we really think about it, it's that hypervigilance just walking while black. If you really think about it, right? There's always that sense of, you know, of doom looming over your head of, you know, if I'm walking in the mall while black or driving while black, when are they going to pull me over, right? Like it's a lot of that kind of foolishness, right? I know that I recently purchased a new vehicle. And I showed a picture of it to my dad. And the first thing he said is, oh, you haven't got pulled over yet?
Wow.
I was like, wow, Dad, really? Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. But what is he speaking to? He's speaking to that hypervigilance of, you know, that sense of we're always having to look around and look out.
Yes.
You know, to wonder, to wonder if. It's not even if, it's when, right? So we're always on that vigilant state.
And I'm glad you talked about how in therapy, Jael, you were able to unlock different parts of you, because I always say this to people, like a therapist is like they give you the keys to unlock so many doors that you never even thought existed. Right. Mm-hmm. And the more you keep unlocking, the more you keep discovering more about yourself and your healing and your growing and your healing journey begins. So, you know, in our community, I really push for us to really normalize therapy and get the stigma of, oh, it's for crazy people, oh, it's for mad people, you know, remove that stigma away and really encourage people to see someone when they're struggling so much on the inside and struggling internally. It's really important. Are there any ways, are there any other ways, Jael, that you addressed your issues? You talked about a poem, you talked about the therapy, you talked about reading books. Are there any other ways?
Mostly reading books and stuff. You talked about, you know, that person who hustles and hustles hard. I'm that black girl, right? I always need to have things doing, or else I feel like I'm wasting time, you know? I'm that person, and I've slowly, let me tell you, it's slow, it's a very slow process. I'm slowly letting go of things and saying, no, I don't want to do this. Not that I can't take it on, but no, I don't want to do this.
That's,
you know,
boundaries.
Giving myself so many boundaries. It's so important to do that. And even like for my kids, like giving my kids more time and all of these things, it's so difficult for, especially when you have a dream and you want to see, you have goals before you're 40 and you want to accomplish them all. You want to check off all those.
You're speaking my language.
And you feel like you have 36 hours in the day and
Speaking my language. Like you're speaking to me. You know what I've learned, Jael, over the years? It's to remove the hustler mindset and replace it with aligning myself. So not everything is a yes for me, especially when it's going to come with stress. I've also told myself I want no more stress money, because there's so many times you get opportunities or whatever. You think it's an opportunity and it just comes with a bag of stress. You think it's really good money, but it comes with a bag of stress. So I'm like, you know what? Let me remove the stress money and incorporate making peace my paycheck. You know, and then when you aligned yourself, you know that this connects to the dots of going the road onto your purpose, right? Rather than take everything, because not everything that is served to you is for you to eat, right? Wow. And so when I get rid of that hustler mentality and I pray on everything, the universe and God will bring things that are aligned for me to shine in my power and to walk in my power. So trust me, I gave myself a deadline to make it super famous like Halle Berry for 6 months. So when I say I know the hustler mentality and that mindset of like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, I'm getting older. Oh my God, this is what I need to accomplish. I know it, but I learned that especially someone that lives with anxiety, it's not helping my anxiety.
Yeah, for me, it's a slow process. Yes. A lot of things happen for me later on in life. Like even me going back to school happened later on in life. Mark you, I had an anxiety attack on my orientation day.
Oh, jeez.
Ended up in the hospital. Oh. Ended up on drips. So it was a lot for me, you know, doing a lot of things later on in life, and then even coming to an understanding as to what I want to do moving forward in my future, and seeing, okay, people say to people have said, you know, in the past, oh, you know, you're getting older, you know, you may still look young, but you're getting older, you know, life as a journalist, you know, I'm like, yo, like black don't crack. Don't you know that? Like, like I'm trying to like now convince myself that I'm going to look this great when I'm 50 and 60.
Yes, honey. Yes.
Yes. So it takes a lot. I feel it takes a lot of work, and it's something that I encourage like a lot of my friends and my family, you know, to consider, like not to be scared, you know, of actually taking that step. One of the things, though, I find a lot of people say to me, a lot of my, especially because I have a large like black community that follows me, mm-hmm. is the cost, you know, the cost. It's always like the cost of therapy, the cost, you know, it's so expensive. It's like, it's white people money, you know, and they say that. Mm-hmm. You know, and they feel like it's so expensive. And yes, we say to them, yes, it's an investment in your health, because if your brain's not working, if your mind's not working, then, you know, you're unable to do the things that may help you earn a living. Mm-hmm. But people still don't understand that, because they look at their forefathers and the people before them who worked enslaved and worked day in, day out, two jobs, three jobs, four jobs, worked until they were 70. And they kind of just take that same trajectory in terms of their life's going to lead.
Right,
so it's very difficult to just say to somebody, hey, you know, dish out $150 an hour every 2 weeks or every month or every week or whatever it is to go and sit down and talk to somebody. And then they're like, well, what exactly am I talking to them about? And even with me going to see a therapist, it was hard for me to even open up and say things that I wanted to say or I needed to say. It took some time to actually get me to open up. And I'm thinking of, you know, friends that I have who probably be exactly like me. That's going to cost them a good $1,000 in like a few sessions, you know, to actually probably start seeing results.
That's right.
And a lot of people don't have that kind of money. And I mean, it's really important for us as black people to know that we have an outlet. We have somewhere to go.
Right.
We have a friend of mine, Ricardo McCrae, who's a very good friend of mine. I remember when I did an interview with him a couple of years ago, he said to me, I spend the most on my mental health. And I was like, I literally asked him, so you crazy? Like, you going through some stuff? like, are you going through some stuff? And he's like, no, I don't want to get to going through some stuff.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So
before I get to that stage, I'm taking care of it.
Exactly.
You know, and I wish that our people would see that. But again, the financial aspect.
Well, I think what's interesting with the financial aspect, and this is what I usually tell people, I go, you either invest in yourself in the front end, or it ends up costing you in the back end. And what's interesting with our community, unfortunately, and especially if we even think about physical illnesses like diabetes and pressure and a lot of the things that plague our community, we'll find the money every month for the medications, for our diabetes, or for our cholesterol, or for our, you know, for all of these things. But if we decided that we wanted to do something in the front end, first of all, in regards to, you know, maybe eating healthier or, you know, exercise and all of those kinds of things, if we invested in the front end, we may have lowered the percentage of getting those things in the back end. So I think what we unfortunately are backwards in the sense of, I understand that therapy is not something that is cheap, and a good therapist is not cheap. I understand that. But I think we always have to, we value, we'll invest in what we value. And I think a lot of times we'll find the, oh, you know, it's just genetic, so I'm going to get diabetes anyway. And then all of a sudden you're spending hundreds of dollars every month on diabetes medication. And I'm like, well, you have that, you know, why don't we then invest in the front end so that we can be preventative, both physically and mentally as well, right? So
yeah.
I think a lot of times, unfortunately, we prefer to do things on the back end of things. You know, we're scrambling afterwards versus how do we invest in ourselves now so that we can actually have a healthier life, body, mind, and spirit, right?
And yeah, and sometimes we also have to look at the bigger picture, unfortunately, with systemic racism and oppression and everything that has placed our people in position where sometimes they can't even afford the healthy food to nourish their bodies, and they can't even afford the therapy. Or sometimes even if the person is struggling with diabetes, they have to beg, borrow, steal in order to pay for it.
That's
so I say, because sometimes we don't have the funds to go seek therapy, is to use ourselves, create a safe space among ourselves, and to talk about it.
Right.
You know how your cousin felt good after three sessions? Maybe she just needed to out something. Maybe she just really needed to talk to somebody, and to talk to someone that is free of judgment, that won't save your session. But you look, oh, you have a nice body, you have care, you have man, you have oats. What do you need to be depressed about? So maybe we need to invest in ourselves and create safe spaces around us where we can start talking about it, and then to normalize it in our community, right? But I definitely understand that because we don't see it, we don't believe it.
Right.
So we go with that whole thing of, we don't see it. So we see diabetes, we see all of this, but we don't see mental illness. So it's not there. But I think that we start by creating safe spaces among us. And that safe space can start within yourself by saying, you know what? Instead of suppressing, we understand that this happened, and it's hard to admit it. It's hard to own your narrative, but seek or find someone that you trust, and find someone that you can open up and share, because you'll feel so much better just letting that load off. Jael, can we go into Jael as to where are you now in since everything is happening from your journey?
Well, I'm still in, I would still say I'm a beginner.
That's good. That's good.
I'm still learning. I don't want to say, oh, I'm, because there's certain times, thankfully I've only had one panic attack since I started therapy. And I stopped therapy for some time, and then I plan to start back again, this time going virtually. But I've used certain things that was said to me, you know, to learn how to cope and how to go ahead. I think a lot of it had to stemmed back from, you know, losing my both parents in the same year. So there was a lot of things going on in my life, and it kind of just brought everything full circle. And I guess I couldn't deal with it in that moment, and that is why I had my first panic attack. But you know, just learning how to cope with so many different things. I still consider myself a beginner. Like, granted, I'll tell people, hey, go get therapy, go get this, go get that. There's certain things go through my mind. Sometimes I'm like, yo, I need to call my therapist.
You know, of course.
You know, I'm a bit more aware though, which
that's
is what
good.
Is, what is different? I'm more aware of when I need to again create boundaries, when I need to ease up, when I need to self-care, when I need to, like, I'm more aware of this. I go every single month, you know, to get, you know, stuff done, whether it's my nails or massages and stuff.
That's right.
I've taken a lot more care. Granted, during the pandemic in Canada, you couldn't do that.
Right.
However, there are other countries where you can get it.
Fair enough. I hear you.
Right. And I remember, you know, even when saying that I was going to travel for some time, I said that to to someone that I work closely with, and his response to me, he's like, that's part of mental health care. That's part of care too. You know, like, because just staying in that situation, you know, being in lockdown, all of that was beginning to take a toll on me, absolutely. You know, mentally and physically and stuff. So, you know, being able to get out, you know, really was important for me to do that and kind of reboot, because I felt that I was really reaching like a pressure point, like almost like a pressure cooker, you know, I was going to explode.
Yes.
And I'm glad that I actually took the step and I went and I saw someone, and it's really helped. It's really helped, but I'm still a beginner. I'm still there to learn. I still want to learn more about myself, you know, and like, even like different things, I think about different things and I write it down. Cause again, I get that from books, because I read Black Girl in Love with Herself by Trey Anthony.
Okay, yes. Right, big up Trey Anthony.
So
that's, I mean, to me, I mean, I'm glad that you said that you're still on this journey, that you are a beginner, you're learning more, you're growing, because I think, you know, especially the people that are listening into this podcast, I think people have to realize that everyone is at different levels of their journey. You know, there are people that are maybe further along, that they, you know, they've been in therapy for years or whatever the case may be. But then also speak to the person who is saying, listen, I am beginning, I'm learning, I'm growing, I'm learning more about myself. And wherever you are, regardless of what aspect of your journey that you're in, it's good. You know, it is all good. So, you know, I appreciate you saying that. So what we want to do is ask you our next question. And then we have a fun question afterwards.
Yeah, there's a fun question coming up. But first,
we want to talk about ask about.
Yeah. How do you think in the Black community we can change the stigma surrounding mental illness and mental health overall?
Wow. I think that is a really tough question. I'm not gonna lie,
right?
Because we're not easy, eh?
that's real Dominican coming out, eh?
that is a real tough question.
It's true.
I think a lot of awareness. You know, a lot of one-on-one personal reaching out. Like if you see like something that I do. And I do it a lot with just people that I don't even know, but people like, because I'm always on social media. I see what people post, and some people are my friends, some people are not, or some people are acquaintances. You know, I reach out and I say, you know, I have this thing now. I say, just be good to yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, I tell everybody, yeah. You know, like I ran into this girl at the grocery store and she kind of looked down, you know, a couple of days ago. And I said to her, I just remember to be good to yourself. And she messaged me after and she's like, yo, Jael, you don't even know what that meant for me, like in that moment,
yes.
You know? So this is something that I've constantly been practicing and practicing, you know, as Black people, we're negative a lot. We're too negative. Right. And I think I've taken a positive approach on everything. Even when I see things being done negatively,
right.
I'm like, yo, where is this coming from? This might be coming from somewhere. Like, you don't know what that person's going through. Like, mm-hmm. Don't judge that person, or don't just misread that person. That person might be going through something and you don't know.
Right.
So I think a lot of it is about awareness and letting people know that, hey, you can speak to me. I'm not a therapist, but if I cannot answer your questions, or if I cannot, I will tell you exactly where to go.
Amen. Right? Amen.
That's encouraging.
Exactly.
Yes.
And that is how that's what works for me. Like I tell, whenever I hang up the phones with my friends, I always tell them, be good to yourself today.
Mm.
You know, be good to yourself today. Forget about yesterday. Forget about tomorrow. Be good to yourself today. You know, a lot of my friends have very stressful work. They work in very stressful environments. And I try to tell them, hey, be good to yourself today. You
yes.
know, and I think, eventually people understand, and when they see people like me and others who are actually advocating for mental health and stuff, they'll understand that, hey, you know, that could be me, you know, I could go get help too. Like it's okay to get help.
Right.
And I'm not going to be considered crazy. I'm not going to be considered cray cray, you know, which is what we tend to call people when,
right.
when people go through depression, even like postpartum depression and stuff, you know, like, we don't even understand that as Black people, especially from the Caribbean. We don't understand having a baby and feeling like you want to kill your baby. That's not supposed to happen to you. You know, like depression. That is,
yeah.
You know, so that is, and that is how I feel like you could reach out to people, making it more personal and less commercial. Because commercial, it just sounds like white people thing.
Right. Yeah, that's true.
That's true. I like that. I like what you said. Just make it more personal and not commercial. I really love that line. Jael, so this is the fun question section now as we round off our interview with you. So I hope you're prepared for this question, okay? So I'll tell you the backstory from this question. One day I was at work and I went to the water cooler and I saw that, you know, I never really told people that I work in the film industry. Anyways, it's the film industry. So I was at work and I saw a sign by the water cooler that said, take one thing for your mental health. And it had different words in little cutoff sections, like little strips just cut off. And you just rip off a word that you feel will be for your mental health that day. And so I've incorporated into the podcast by asking our guests, what is one word, just one word that you feel that can sum up your mental health journey? Or your journey with mental
roller coaster.
Oh, I like that. I like that. You know what?
Yeah.
And I love what, okay, please explain, because yes, Natasha loves that part. Natasha needs to know.
I need to know, you know, why you chose the word roller coaster.
Well, sometimes you're going to have like really good days where you're up there.
Amen.
And sometimes you're going to have really bad days. But my thing, you know, when you're on the roller coaster and you're going and you're going at a speed and you feel, oh, you want to put your hands up. Just remember that you can make the up and the down that ride.
Oh, I love it. And you know what, too, Jael? It keeps going, right? At the end of the day, you keep going. So I love
that one.
That. Yes. Wow. Yes. I love that.
My gosh. Jael, all I can say is thank you. Thank you so much for being open and sharing your story with us and our listeners. I know that your story and your continued journey is going to bless so many people because your test is now a testimony for others and your life is a testimony and will be a healing agent for others. So Jael, thank you so much for just A, being you, and B, taking the time out to share your journey with us. Thank you.
And thank you to both of you for creating a platform where people of color, Black people especially, can come and talk about these things. I mean, some of us want to talk, some of us don't, you know? Mm-hmm. But hopefully, you know, you get more people who are willing to speak out, you know, and so we can hopefully get rid of all the taboo and all the stigma that's associated with mental health. And thanks for having me on your show. It was really a pleasure speaking with the both of you. You know, us island people, you know?
And I just wanted to say, this is the first conversation where I've heard a lot of your accent come out, Dr. Natasha. Because, this is the first conversation. So, at one point, I'm like, should I bring up my patois too? Because,
right?
While we just are talking our accents, I'm ever bring up my accent. Why not? I just love it.
Being you 100%. I in my podcast, I actually tell people at the start of it, I code switch a lot. So you get with the program. You know, like,
that's right.
I speak English. Open your ears, you'll hear. Right.
Yes, as long as you can understand me. Yes, exactly. Yes.
Exactly.
I love that. Yes. It was a pleasure. It was
an absolute pleasure, Jael. Thank you so, so much. You take care. You have a good rest
you
of the
too.
Day, okay?
And be good to yourself.
Well.
Yes, be
me.
Good
Bye-bye.
To yourself.
Okay.
Be good to yourself.
You've reached the end of another episode of the Blind Stigma Podcast with your hosts, Stacy-Ann Buchanan and Dr. Natasha Williams. Thank you for tuning in. If you're a first-time listener and you like the show, then please subscribe, rate, and review us on all the major podcast platforms. Don't forget to connect with us on social media at The Blind Stigma and join the conversation. Find out more about each guest and help us to change the stigma while taking back our narratives. This podcast is produced by What's Up Toronto and Stacy-Ann Buchanan Productions.